I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Adam Hall's chess match of continental intrigue. Queen in Danger. Starring Juliette Mills. Robert Brown. And Murray Matheson. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
The Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by Chevrolet and State Farm Insurance. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
Rarely does one find a detective in the social register. Hugo Bishop, London's super sleuth, is an exception. He's a whippet-like, non-violent man with a penchant for chess. He prefers milkshakes to ale and has a reputation for being in the right place at the right time. This should lend solace to the overwrought Thelma Tasman. Hugo Bishop is on her case. The case of her husband, actually. Convicted killer Mervyn Spate, who recently escaped from Broadmoor Asylum for the criminally insane. The fact is, Thelma finds Bishop's unorthodox methods disquieting. Nevertheless, Hugo and his intuitive secretary, Vera Gorringe, press on. Staying close to Thelma Tasman are publisher Maurice Gerald, her employer and steadfast friend, fashion photographer Rex Willison, a volunteer male companion, Freddie Frisney of Scotland Yard, and of course, Hugo Bishop. Oddly, Thelma's common-law husband, Victor Tasman, is out of town. Hugo Bishop has never met the man, but would like to. He'd like to look him in the eye to see if there's a resemblance to a series of sketches he's been shown by Mervyn Spate, because Hugo Bishop is convinced that Mervyn Spate is innocent and the man portrayed in the sketches is not. Queen in Danger continues following this.
What was Mervyn waiting for, I wondered. I knew he had learned of my identity as Gloria Del Rey and my address as Mrs. Victor Tasman. I was certain he meant to kill me as he had killed Joanna Martin. Was he waiting for Victor to return? Or waiting only to torture me? If that was his intention, it was working. The longer he waited, the more my terror grew.
Yes, miss.
He was a small, thin man, bald as a billiard ball. His nose was hooked, as if years of sniffing at articles brought to him for sale had caused it to turn under. His shoulders were slightly humped, their blades visible beneath his old sweater, making him look like a bird of prey with its large wings folded. He leaned forward in the dim light, assuming the posture of a vulture among the littered display of cast-off clothing, kit bags, golf clubs, cameras, binoculars, violins and guitars, and guns.
Can I do something for you?
There's something in your window.
There's many things.
The little black gun.
Yes, I thought perhaps. In my business, you guess, so you can tell. I'll get it for you. There it is, miss. It's small, it's light. Just right for a young woman such as yourself.
Have you suitable ammunition?
Well, I may have. Yes, I may have. But, have you a license?
No,
it's not always easy to get a license, you know. One must have a reason for carrying a gun. They always are.
I shall be able to satisfy them. How much is the gun?
Well, with the clips of ammunition I think I could find, the gun will be 12 pounds.
I haven't that amount with me.
I will accept your check, miss. I don't accept checks as a rule, but I will accept yours.
I prefer to pay cash. I have about 10 pounds with me.
It's the perfect little weapon for you. I say, would it be possible for you to bring the additional 2 pounds in later?
No. I shan't be this way again.
Then I suppose... miss. I won't neglect my chance of doing you a service.
And the ammunition?
Oh, yes. Here you are.
Thank you.
My shop is so dusty and dark. Few young ladies as beautiful as you come into it. You bring it life. You take away death.
I paid the 10 pounds, dropped the gun into my handbag and walked briskly out of the dark little shop, away from the little vulture man. I stepped out onto the sidewalk, back into the bright afternoon sun, and ran straight into the ubiquitous Hugo Bishop.
Well, hello.
Did you follow me here, Mr. Bishop?
I might ask you the same. Did you follow me?
Sorry. I suppose that was an odd thing to think.
Well, quite understandable. That is, as understandable as any coincidence can be. I'm merely waiting for the garage across the way to check the oil in my car, and you're simply doing some shopping.
Yes, of course.
The only coincidence is that my garage and your shop happen to be opposite. I was whiling away my time. In fact, staring into that extraordinary pawn shop window must contain everything in the world.
I'm afraid you'll have to excuse me, Mr. Bishop. I have still another show to cover.
Well, let me run you over there. You'll have finished my car by now.
It actually isn't far.
Ah, well then you'll be in good time. Come along.
What is it, Mr. Bishop? You seem different now than last night when you came to help me.
Different? How?
Well, you were very kind. You offered just what I needed, a sort of quiet strength.
That's me. I'm the archetype of a strong, silent man.
You would be if you didn't try to be so facetious.
Me facetious, Mrs. Tasman? Very well. I'll be serious, if you'd like. Who are you trying to shield?
I don't understand.
Are you trying to shield Victor Tasman? Or Maurice Gerald? Or Rex Willison? Or someone whose name I don't know? Someone called the Gent. I watched her face as I asked my question, naming the men around her. But she only looked bewildered. That perhaps was my answer. Now she sat quietly beside me as I drove her to the next show.
I've been trying to understand what you meant. What would I be trying to shield them from?
Hanging.
Hanging? Victor, Maurice, Rex.
Thelma, there is the theory being considered now that your husband, Mervyn Spate, might truly be innocent.
Mervyn innocent? But he's been proven mad.
Yes, and that has become your obsession.
I lived with Mervyn. I saw his terrible temper.
That doesn't mean he's done murder.
But if he didn't...
Someone else did. Someone close to you, I should think. Someone you might be trying to protect because he means more to you than Mervyn Spate.
But I believe Mervyn did it. I believe he's mad.
Yes, I rather think you do. And perhaps you're right. But Mervyn believes he's innocent and sane, and that perhaps you're shielding the real murderer.
Poor mad Mervyn. Before our marriage was a year old, we'd stopped loving each other. And I'd begun to be afraid. Afraid of his unreasonable rages.
And now you fear his madness?
Yes.
Here we are, Park Court.
Thank you again, Mr. Bishop.
Where will you be going after this show you're covering?
There's a cocktail bash at the Lotus Bowl.
Are the gates crashable?
Will you come?
I just might. With a guest, if I may.
Of course. Who is it?
Lady Farisham. A dear old thing I picked up at the garden fest. You'd adore her. Though I should warn you of one thing.
What's that?
She's a bit nervous. So do be careful not to let anything go off in your handbag. I thought about Thelma buying the gun and wondered why. To defend herself if Spate showed up. Her obsession might have driven her to that point. I had no way of knowing if she bought the thing by plan or by impulse. I found Freddy Frisnay wrestling with the same knobby issue.
What do you make of the Tasman woman, in light of a new role?
You mean now that she's toting a rod?
Precisely.
Freddy, so your man was shopping with her, was he?
Of course. He had more trouble keeping out of your way than hers.
He shouldn't be so sensitive. I wouldn't bite him. Freddy, why do you think she's bought a gun?
To shoot someone with. Hmm.
A couple of rare sleuths we are. By the by, Freddy, my man.
I am not your man.
Oh, Freddy, just a figure of speech, old boy. Have you any records at the Yard on a bloke called the Gent?
Several. It's not uncommon, you know. Any hoodlum who sports a Woolworths tie pin gets the name.
Well, check the lot. The one I'm interested in was described as a tough, a businessman sort. Had a car, middle-aged, a big man.
That narrows it. We'll check. Is he someone who might have been involved with Joanna Martin?
Yes. A lot of blokes were, apparently. And while you're at it, you might also check an Emerson. Little man with glasses. Had a car, some money. And a Sydney. A flash type. Smoked cigars, wore rings. Cocky little rat.
Why didn't you put me onto these characters over our lunch?
You weren't inclined to consider anyone else but Spade at that point, as I recall.
Don't misread me, Hugo. I'm still not. That is, not officially.
Good old cautious Freddy.
I'll follow your leads and keep in touch. Now, don't push me.
Cocktails at the Lotus Bowl. I'm agreeable, but what are we doing?
Just keeping our fingers in the pie.
Who am I supposed to be at this bash, did you say?
Lady Vanisham, a dear old baggage I picked up at a horse fair.
The name is reasonable. I dislike the description.
Well, how about a bit of fluff I picked up at a carpet sale?
In any event, an English eccentric of some 60 summers who's a nut on fashion.
That's the birdie. Lorgnette, jet locket, dodo feather fan, and tweed galoshes.
Sounds like fun. I'll go to work on it.
And of course, one thing to keep in mind this evening.
What's that?
The Queen is packing a gas. When Gory returned, she was dressed to the nines for her party role as Lady Verisham. Expensive basic black cultured pearls and her blue rinse piled high in an elegant upsweep.
The old baggage from the horse fair has arrived.
Pardon, madam. Oh?
Is this Bishop?
It is.
This is Mervyn Spate.
Spate wanted to talk to me. We arranged the meeting place. It meant we both would have to shinny our way through the police and Scotland Yard dragnet. It also meant that Gory and I would have to forego our cocktail date with Thelma Tasman and company at the Lotus Bowl. My rendezvous with Spate seemed more important. And now I had something more urgent for Gory to do as well. I gave her a list of names. There were people I wanted to have on deck later tonight, if the plan I had in mind took shape.
Lovely. I always get gussied up in my best basic black and pearls to spend the evening on the telephone.
Don't worry. Lady Barisham may have her hour of glory yet.
Where are you meeting Spate?
Oh, round.
Cagey.
Reasons?
Dangerous?
Depends. Is Spate a lunatic killer, or isn't he?
I don't think you should go without telling me where to look for your body.
With the police all around Spate as they are, they'll find my remains PDQ. So you don't have to worry your beautiful blue rinse about that.
Some consolation you're leaving me with.
Ah, no. Gory girl, don't go sentimental on me. Now, you get on the blower, and I'll see you later. With luck. I found Spate waiting on the embankment of the Thames between Vauxhall Bridge and the Chelsea Bridge, crouched beside the dark water, chilled and cramped, hungry and exhausted. Spate.
It's me, Bishop.
I wasn't sure you'd come.
I said I would. I brought you some food, but you better eat it slowly.
Oh, thank you.
The police are moving across this whole area. They'll be coming down here by land and by water.
I know. They nearly had me twice.
You said you wanted to talk. We don't have long.
Last time we met, I got the feeling you might help me.
I think I have been. Provided you didn't actually murder Joanna Martin.
Dear God. I thought there was only one other man living who could consider I didn't do it. The man who did.
And you didn't kill the girl, Spade.
At my trial, I got tired of saying no. Sometimes at the asylum, I said I did. It never seemed to matter much which I said. You really want to know?
I do.
No, I did not kill her.
You saw the man who did?
I saw him.
The man in your sketches?
Yes.
Can I see them again?
Very well.
I'll have to wait until we get close to where the light is better. I want you to come with me, Spade.
Come with you? Where?
Where we can get you some rest.
If I stay here, they'll get me. I may as well come with you. But look here. You cross me, Bishop, and so help me, I'll kill you.
Kill me?
Nelly, everybody says I'm a murderer, don't they?
There's something you should know, Spade. If the real murderer has got himself close to your wife for his own reasons, she doesn't know it.
Are you sure of that?
Quite sure. Come on. Better get out of here.
Wait, Bishop. You're taking a chance doing this. Tell me why.
Don't try to figure me out, Spade. There isn't time.
Hugo Bishop had made such a point of planning to gatecrash the cocktail party at the Lotus Bowl. Why hadn't he shown up, I wondered? There'd been no sign of him. Or Lady Verisham, whoever she might be. Again, as I lost the protection of the crowd around me and was faced with another night of lonely panic, I sought the comforting male companionship of Rex Willison.
What is it, Thelma? You've been edgy all evening.
I expected someone tonight who didn't come, that's all.
Will you have dined, you love?
I liked your company, Rex.
Great. I've always wanted a kid sister.
Poor boy. When a woman doesn't want you for your rippling torso, you just get lost in the forest, don't you?
That's Gloria Del Rey and her fashion talk.
And you'd rather have fashion talk. Well,
just because I asked you to my flat doesn't mean I wanted to show you my etchings. You said something about dreading another night alone.
I said that?
You did, love.
I'm sorry. It only means I miss Victor.
Of course. But he's away and I'm here.
And you've been just what I needed. You told me 3 genuinely funny stories and gave me a marvelous dinner. And now you're going to see me safely home.
I am? Yes, I suppose I am.
But as soon as Rex had seen me inside my door and left me alone as I asked him to, I was sorry I'd sent him away. Sorry I hadn't gone to his flat. I could have dealt with him. Anything would be better than my renewed feeling of panic. I tried telephoning Rex, but there was no answer. Victor. I had to hear the sound of Victor's voice again.
Bristol Motel.
Mr. Victor Tasman, please.
I'm sorry, Mr. Tasman has checked out.
Checked out? Are you sure?
Just a moment, I'll make certain. Yes, Mr. Tasman left at 8:00, just over an hour ago.
Did he say where he was going?
No, I'm sorry, he did not.
I see. Thank you. This is Thelma Tasman. Is Mr. Bishop there?
No, I'm sorry, Mrs. Tasman. He's not just now.
Well, tell him I called, will you?
Oh, Mrs. Tasman. He'll want to know where he can reach you later. What shall I tell him?
Tell him I'll call back. I was afraid to leave, but even more afraid to stay. I decided to spend the night at a hotel somewhere on the other side of the city. I phoned for a taxi, gathered up my wrap and handbag, and cautiously opened the door. Then I remembered the gun. I had taken it out to load it and placed it in the drawer of my bedside table. I hurried back to get it. Then I remembered I had left the door to my apartment open. I heard the sound of the lift gates at the other end of the passage. Did I really hear it, or was it in my imagination? But now, there were muffled footsteps coming down the passage toward my door. I mustn't see him. I couldn't stand the sight of his face, his killer hands, his eyes that were mad. My fingers closed around the gun. I heard the small click of the safety catch as I released it. His footsteps drew closer. Slowly, quietly. Then, suddenly, the stream of light was broken by the dark shadow of his silhouette, and the gun in my hand went off.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, Queen in Danger. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour. Rarely does one find a detective in the social register. Hugo Bishop, London's super sleuth, is an exception. He's a whippet-like, non-violent man with a penchant for chess. He prefers milkshakes to ale and has a reputation for being in the right place at the right time. This should lend solace to the overwrought Thelma Tasman. Hugo Bishop is on her case. The case of her husband, actually. Convicted killer Mervyn Spate, who recently escaped from Broadmoor Asylum for the criminally insane. The fact is, Thelma finds Bishop's unorthodox methods disquieting. Nevertheless, Hugo and his intuitive secretary, Vera Gorringe, press on. Staying close to Thelma Tasman are publisher Maurice Gerald, her employer and steadfast friend, fashion photographer Rex Willison, a volunteer male companion, Freddie Frisney of Scotland Yard, and of course Hugo Bishop. Oddly, Thelma's common-law husband, Victor Tasman, is out of town. Hugo Bishop has never met the man, but would like to. He'd like to look him in the eye, to see if there's a resemblance to a series of sketches he's been shown by Mervyn Spate, because Hugo Bishop is convinced that Mervyn Spate is innocent, and the man portrayed in the sketches is not. Queen in Danger continues following this.
What was Mervyn waiting for, I wondered. I knew he had learned of my identity as Gloria Del Rey and my address as Mrs. Victor Tasman. I was certain he meant to kill me as he had killed Joanna Martin. Was he waiting for Victor to return? Or waiting only to torture me? If that was his intention, it was working. The longer he waited, the more my terror grew.
Yes, miss.
He was a small, thin man, bald as a billiard ball. His nose was hooked, as if years of sniffing at articles brought to him for sale had caused it to turn under. His shoulders were slightly humped, their blades visible beneath his old sweater, making him look like a bird of prey with its large wings folded. He leaned forward in the dim light, assuming the posture of a vulture among the littered display of cast-off clothing, kit bags, golf clubs, cameras, binoculars, violins and guitars, and guns.
Can I do something for you?
There's something in your window.
There's many things.
The little black gun.
Oh, yes, I thought perhaps. In my business, you guess, so you can tell. I'll get it for you. There it is, is, miss. It's small, it's light. Just right for a young woman such as yourself.
Have you suitable ammunition?
Well, I may have. Yes, I may have. But, have you a license?
No,
it's not always easy to get a license, you know. One must have a reason for carrying a gun. They always ask.
I shall be able to satisfy them. How much is the gun?
Well, with the clips of ammunition I think I could find, the gun will be £12.
I haven't that amount with me.
I will accept your check, miss. I don't accept checks as a rule, but I will accept yours.
I'd prefer to pay cash. I have about £10 with me.
It's a perfect little weapon for you. I say, would it be possible for you to bring the additional £2 in later?
No. I shan't be this way again.
Well, then I suppose... Very well, miss. I won't neglect my chance of doing you a service.
And the ammunition?
Oh, yes, yes, here you are.
Thank you.
My shop is so dusty and dark. Few young ladies as beautiful as you come into it. You bring it life. You take away death.
I paid the £10, dropped the gun into my handbag and walked briskly out of the dark little shop, away from the little vulture man. I stepped out onto the sidewalk, back into the bright afternoon sun, and ran straight into the ubiquitous Hugo Bishop.
Well, hello.
Did you follow me here, Mr. Bishop?
I might ask you the same. Did you follow me?
Sorry. I suppose that was an odd thing to think.
Well, quite understandable. That is, as understandable as any coincidence can be. I'm merely waiting for the garage across the way to check the oil in my car, and you're simply doing some shopping.
Yes, of course.
The only coincidence is that my garage and your shop happen to be opposite. I was whiling away my time. In fact, staring into the extraordinary pawn shop window must contain everything in the world.
I'm afraid you have to excuse me, Mr. Bishop. I have still another show to cover.
Well, let me run you over there. You'll have finished my car by now.
It actually isn't far.
Ah, well then you'll be in good time. Come along.
What is it, Mr. Bishop? You seem different now than last night when you came to help me.
Different? How?
Well, you were very kind. You offered just what I needed, a sort of quiet strength.
That's me. I'm the archetype of strong, silent man.
You would be if you didn't try to be so facetious.
Me facetious, Mrs. Tasman? Very well. I'll be serious, if you'd like. Who are you trying to shield?
I don't understand.
Are you trying to shield Victor Tasman? Or Maurice Gerald? Or Rex Willison? Or someone whose name I don't know? Someone called the Gent. I watched her face as I asked my question, naming the men around her. But she only looked bewildered. That perhaps was my answer. Now she sat quietly beside me as I drove her to the next show.
I've been trying to understand what you meant. What would I be trying to shield them from?
Hanging.
Hanging? Victor, Maurice, Rex.
Thelma, there is the theory being considered now that your husband, Mervyn Spate, might truly be innocent.
Mervyn innocent? But he's been proven mad.
Yes, and that has become your obsession.
I lived with Mervyn. I saw his terrible temper.
That doesn't mean he's done murder.
But if he didn't...
Someone else did. Someone close to you, I should think. Someone you might be trying to protect because he means more to you than Mervyn Spate.
But I believe Mervyn did it. I believe he's mad.
Yes, I rather think you do. And perhaps you're right. But Mervyn believes he's innocent and sane, and that perhaps you're shielding the real murderer.
Poor mad Mervyn. Before our marriage was a year old, we'd stopped loving each other. And I'd begun to be afraid. Afraid of his unreasonable rages.
And now you fear his madness?
Yes.
Here we are, Park Court.
Thank you again, Mr. Bishop.
Where will you be going? after this show you're covering?
There's a cocktail bash at the Lotus Bowl.
Are the gates crashable?
Will you come?
I just might. With a guest, if I may.
Of course. Who is it?
Lady Farisham. A dear old thing I picked up at the garden fete. You'd adore her. Though I should warn you of one thing.
What's that?
She's a bit nervous. So do be careful not to let anything go off in your handbag. I thought about Thelma buying the gun and wondered why. To defend herself if Spate showed up. Her obsession might have driven her to that point. I had no way of knowing if she bought the thing by plan or by impulse. I found Freddy Frisnay wrestling with the same knobby issue.
What do you make of the Tasman woman, in light of a new role?
You mean now that she's toting a rod?
Precisely.
Freddy, so your man was shopping with her, was he?
Of course. He had more trouble keeping out of your way than hers.
He shouldn't be so sensitive. I wouldn't bite him. Freddy, why do you think she's bought a gun?
To shoot someone with. Hmm.
Couple of rare sleuths we are. By the by, Freddy, my man.
I am not your man.
Oh, Freddy, just a figure of speech, old boy. Have you any records at the yard on a bloke called the Gent?
Several. It's not uncommon, you know. Any hoodlum who sports a Woolworths tie pin gets the name.
Well, checked a lot. The one I'm interested in was described as a tough, a businessman sort. Had a car, middle-aged, a big man.
That narrows it. We'll check. Is he someone who might have been involved with Joanna Martin?
Yes. A lot of blokes were, apparently. And while you're at it, you might also check an Emerson. Little man with glasses. Had a car, some money. And a Sydney. A flash type. Smoked cigars, wore rings. Cocky little rat.
Why didn't you put me onto these characters over our lunch?
You weren't inclined to consider anyone else but Spade at that point, as I recall.
Don't misread me, Hugo. I'm still not. That is, not officially.
Good old cautious Freddy.
I'll follow your leads and keep in touch. Now, don't push me.
Cocktails at the Lotus Bowl. I'm agreeable, but what are we doing?
Just keeping our fingers in the pie.
Who am I supposed to be at this bash, did you say?
Lady Varisham, a dear old baggage I picked up at a horse fair.
The name is reasonable. I dislike the description.
Well, how about a bit of fluff I picked up at a carpet sale?
In any event, an English eccentric of some 60 summers who's a nut on fashion.
That's the birdie. Lorgnette, jet locket, dodo feather fan, and tweed galoshes.
Sounds like fun. I'll go to work on it.
And of course, one thing to keep in mind this evening.
What's that?
The Queen is packing a gas. When Gory returned, she was dressed to the nines for her party role as Lady Verisham. Expensive basic black cultured pearls and her blue rinse piled high in an elegant upsweep.
The old baggage from the horse fair has arrived.
Pardon, madam. Well?
Is this Bishop?
It is.
This is Mervyn Spate.
Spate wanted to talk to me. We arranged the meeting place. It meant we both would have to shinny our way through the police and Scotland Yard dragnet. It also meant that Gory and I would have to forego our cocktail date with Thelma Tasman and company at the Lotus Bowl. My rendezvous with Spate seemed more important. And now I had something more urgent for Gory to do as well. I gave her a list of names. There were people I wanted to have on deck later tonight, if the plan I had in mind took shape.
Lovely. I always get gussied up in my best basic black and pearls to spend the evening on the telephone.
Don't worry. Lady Farisham may have her hour of glory yet.
Where are you meeting Spate?
Oh, round.
Cagey.
Reasons?
Dangerous?
Depends. Is Spate a lunatic killer, or isn't he?
I don't think you should go without telling me where to look for your body.
With the police all around Spate as they are, they'll find my remains PDQ. So you don't have to worry your beautiful blue rinse about that.
Some consolation you're leaving me with.
Ah, no. Gory girl, don't go sentimental on me. Now, you get on the blower, and I'll see you later. With luck. I found Spate waiting on the embankment of the Thames between Vauxhall Bridge and the Chelsea Bridge, crouched beside the dark water, chilled and cramped, hungry and exhausted. Spate. It's me, Bishop.
I wasn't sure you'd come.
I said I would. I've brought you some food, but you'd better eat it slowly.
Oh, thank you, thank you.
The police are moving across this whole area. They'll be coming down here by land and by water.
I know. I know, no, no. They nearly had me twice.
You said you wanted to talk. We don't have long.
Last time we met, I got the feeling you might help me.
I think I have been. Provided you didn't actually murder Joanna Martin.
Oh, dear God. I thought there was only one other man living who could consider I didn't do it. The man who did.
And you didn't kill the girl, Spade.
At my trial, I got tired of saying no, no. Sometimes at the asylum, I said, I did. It never seemed to matter much which I said. You really want to know?
I do.
No, I did not kill her.
You saw the man who did?
I saw him.
The man in your sketches?
Yes.
Can I see them again?
Very well.
I'll have to wait until we get close to where the light is better.
We?
I want you to come with me, Spade.
Come with you? Where?
Where we can get you some rest.
If I stay here, they'll get me. I may as well come with you. But look here. You cross me, Bishop, and so help me, I'll kill you.
Kill me?
Really? Everybody says I'm a murderer, don't they?
There's something you should know, Spade. If the real murderer has gotten himself close to your wife for his own reasons, she doesn't know it.
Are you sure of that?
Quite sure. Come on. Better get out of here.
Wait, Bishop. You're taking a chance doing this. Tell me why.
Don't try to figure me out, Spade. There isn't time.
Hugo Bishop had made such a point of planning to gatecrash the cocktail party at the Lotus Bowl. Why hadn't he shown up, I wondered? There'd been no sign of him, or Lady Verisham, whoever she might be. Again, as I lost the protection of the crowd around me and was faced with another night of lonely panic, I sought the comforting male companionship of Rex Willison.
What is it, Thelma? You've been edgy all evening.
I expected someone tonight who didn't come, that's all.
Will you have dined, you love?
I like your company, Rex.
Great. I've always wanted a kid sister.
Poor boy. When a woman doesn't want you for your rippling torso, you just get lost in the forest, don't you?
That's Gloria Del Rey and her fashion talk.
And you'd rather have fashion talk.
Just because I asked you to my flat doesn't mean I wanted to show you my etchings. You said something about dreading another night alone.
I said that?
You did, love.
I'm sorry. It only means I miss Victor.
Of course. But he's away and I'm here.
And you've been just what I needed. You told me 3 genuinely funny stories and gave me a marvelous dinner. And now you're going to see me safely home.
I am? Yes. I suppose I am.
But as soon as Rex had seen me inside my door and left me alone as I asked him to, I was sorry I'd sent him away. Sorry I hadn't gone to his flat. I could have dealt with him. Anything would be better than my renewed feeling of panic. I tried telephoning Rex, but there was no answer. Victor. I had to hear the sound of Victor's voice again.
Bristol Motel.
Mr. Victor Tasman, please.
I'm sorry, Mr. Tasman is checked out.
Checked out? Are you sure?
Just a moment, I'll make certain. Yes, Mr. Tasman left at 8:00, just over an hour ago.
Did he say where he was going?
No, I'm sorry, he did not.
I see. Thank you. This is Thelma Tasman. Is Mr. Bishop there?
No, I'm sorry, Mrs. Tasman. He's not just now.
Well, tell him I called, will you?
Oh, Mrs. Tasman. He'll want to know where he can reach you later. What shall I tell him?
Tell him... Tell him I'll call back. I was afraid to leave, but even more afraid to stay. I decided to spend the night at a hotel somewhere on the other side of the city. I phoned for a taxi, gathered up my wrap and handbag, and cautiously opened the door. Then I remembered the gun. I had taken it out to load it and placed it in the drawer of my bedside table. I hurried back to get it. Then I remembered I had left the door to my apartment open. I heard the sound of the lift gates at the other end of the passage. Did I really hear it, or was it in my imagination? But now, there were muffled footsteps coming down the passage toward my door. I mustn't see him. I couldn't stand the sight of his face, his killer hands, his eyes that were mad. My fingers closed around the gun. I heard the small click of the safety catch as I released it. His footsteps drew closer. Slowly, quietly. Then, suddenly, the stream of light was broken by the dark shadow of his silhouette, and the gun in my hand went off.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, Queen in Danger. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour.
You have been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater. Heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in tomorrow and once again,
rest your eyes and listen here
to The Zero Hour.
This is Mutual, your news and sports radio network.